The metal gates are firmly shut. They are blemished with age, but still strong. These gates are shut for a reason. No visitors allowed. Brusca? You let me in, I'm sure. This woman's head is lined with worry, though her thick build suggests that she could snap a spear in two without much effort. She continually glances toward the tunnel leading out of the courtyard, as though she hopes to see somebody. She runs a hand through her short, graying hair and mutters, "Gods." She thinks, "That's two missing. Where the hell are they?" Finally, she takes notice of you. The wrinkles on her face harden immediately. "What are you looking at?" She jutts a thumb toward the massive gate behind her. "Nobody gets in the fortress without permission. I can already tell you don't have it, so keep walking." "You look worried about something. What's wrong?" "Ooh, gold and red, both small amount." She gives you a wry grin. "It's that obvious? You'd be worried too if you had two patrols go missing and you were stuck on guard duty."
"Making a note."
"Listen, if you happen to see my missing soldiers, I'd appreciate whatever news you can give me. They'll be outfitted like me." She indicates her studded leather armor. "I'd go looking for them myself, but..." She gives a kind of surrendered shrug, leaving her thought unfinished. "Where should I start looking for your missing patrols?"
"Making a note."
"Both of the patrols were tasked with collecting duties from the gangs. They're probably somewhere in the vast interior or one of the slums, but I haven't heard from them in some time. Given the nature of the bloom, they could literally be anywhere." "Somewhere in the vast interior, I hope, or maybe one of the slums. If you don't find them there, I'll be lucky to see any of them again." "If I find you're missing people, will you let me inside?" She gives you a pitying look. "I don't decide who gets in. I just keep everyone else out. But if you find my men, I'll give you something for your trouble." "What can you tell me about the Memorvira?" "She's someone you don't want to cross. Like me." "What can you tell me about yourself?" "Someone else I don't want to cross?" "Ah, right. I've heard about you folks in the cliffs. I guess I can't get away from you without answering some questions, can I?" "I've been in the Memorvira's service for years, ever since she first came into power. She's not one to mess with, let me tell you. She'll squash anyone in her way just to keep things tidy." She gets a faraway look in her eyes. "At least, that's how it used to be. Things are different now. The bloom's acting strange, and even some of the gangs are getting out of control. Never crossed the Memorvira, but these days it seems there are plenty of others you shouldn't cross either." She thinks, "I used to think we kept the bloom safe, for most anyway. I should know better. Nobody's safe in here." "You said the bloom is acting strangely?" "It used to be that the bloom sort of favored us because we worked for the Memorvira. She seemed to predict things it would do or a new moss that would open, but now it's dangerous for us to go too deep, else the bloom itself might swallow some of us whole. That's if we can find our way in the first place. With the moss closing and shifting like they are, it's a wonder my patrols ever get back to the fortress at all." "It's like it hates us. It's becoming more aggressive all the time, shifting moss underneath us sometimes or just closing off the way home entirely." "The gangs are out of control? Can you tell me something about them?" "Too many to tell, but I can list a few you're likely to find nearby. There's the Murdens down there where the old slave block used to be. We've tried to run them out a few times, but there always seem to be more. Can't figure out why the bloom doesn't bother them. There's the mutants in Little Nylash. Let me point out that they named the place. Like they're trying to make a new Nylash right here, with them as the rulers. They didn't used to give us trouble, but they've gotten bolder since the bloom started acting up. I'm not sure which is worse at this point. Then there's Artaglio and his bunch. They stay mostly in the slump. They're not so much of a gang as they are a bunch of freeloaders, but they cause enough trouble with the other gangs that they're worth mentioning." "In decreasing order of trouble, there's the Murdens and the old slave block, the mutants of so-called Little Nylash, and Artaglio and his freeholders. I mean, mercenaries. All of them are more work for me and my men. I need to see the Memorvira." She places a casual hand on the hilt of a large blade. Nobody sees the Memovera, not unless you got permission from someone who matters. You don't understand. I need to see the Memovera. I'm afraid you don't understand. If you persist in your ignorance, I know of one sure way to get it into your head. She grips the hilt of her blade more tightly and sneers. Let me know if I'm not getting through to you. Okay, let's not lie then. Grunts. Okay. I think we may have explored this whole place except for getting this thing to kill us. There's also something that I want to look at. Kaleidoscopic Merecaster? I'm not sure if this is the one where we found Mazov? As you cradle this device in your hands, you smell the tang of salt water, and the ground beneath your feet seems to shudder and sway. The mirror within it calls to you in soothing, rhythmic pulses. You peer through the device into a void far larger than the thing in your hands could contain. From the far end, a shapeless mass reaches across the distance faster than a blink, and obscures your view of it with an amorphous limb. Huh. Maybe this is one we haven't been in. Hold on a second, because I'm curious now. This is the floral Merecaster. Unresponsive. Circulating one. These are the ones we went in already. Twisted metal. Huh. We can access that one again. Alright, let's go into this one then. The kaleidoscopic, and then we'll look at this one, twisted metal one. Indigo waves rise in the wake of the huge, martling whale bearing down on Sega's cliffs. Its flank blots out the sun. Its shadow sweeps over your meager dhow and a whole swath of sea. Awesome. From high up on the beast's back, a lookout leans down. Plague! He cries, in a voice that seems too faint, even considering the distance. His warning is unnecessary. The yellowjack flag flapping from the mast can be seen all the way from the city. As the lookout stares directly at your dhow, he cocks his head quizzically and rubs his eyes, plainly confused to see no one in the boat. The light bender on your belt does its work well, while its charge lasts. After a moment, the man wanders off. Snug around your neck, a steel collar trembles, and a voice whispers in your head. Hurry. Our seaward batteries can turn the whale to mist if they must, but better to save our fire for a darker day. After a moment, the collar buzzes again, and the voice adds, Eliminating contagion is doctor's work, and no doctor would use a saw when a scalpel will do. Go, now, cut what you must, and make sure that this sickness does not reach our city. Finally, the voice says, And don't worry, your body can't fall prey to their disease. The collar goes still. The whale's leathery side looms above you like a living cliff. Somewhere up there are the men and women carrying death toward your home. Gather any gear in a dhow. The tools of your trade are housed in a locker beneath the thwart. Hooked climbing claws, your wind-slice blade, and concussive crystal pulsing with explosive power. You quickly secure them, claws on your hands, sword at your side, crystal on your belt. Remaining in the locker is a small waterproof ledger, which is better left there. There is also a harpoon of azure steel, sunk deep in the whale's flesh and tied to the dhow by a sturdy cable. It would be hard to pull free, and in any case it would keep your boat tied to the beast. Read the ledger. Judging it too long to read in its entirety, you open to a page at random. In a meticulous hand, there is a date, and below it, 3 for the greater good. You flip to another page, and it is similarly no more than a date and a short entry. 1 for the greater good. 1 of necessity. As you skim, only the dates and numbers change. Any contemplation is cut short by a shudder from your collar and a sharp voice in your mind. Do not tarry. Should we risk not tarrying and search the dhow for anything else of use? There is nothing, and the collar around your neck is buzzing insistently, though wordlessly. Use the climbing claws to scale the whale's side. You sink the climbing claws into the whale's tough hide, and leaving a bloody trail behind you. Sorry, guys. Quickly climb your way up. As you ascend, the steady lapping of waves fades and the wind grows, but there come no sounds of the living or dying village built upon the Martling's back. Finally, you crest the whale's flank and pull yourself over the top. Silence, like a miasma, hangs over the empty driftwood shacks. Bits of bone, sheets of synth, crude abandoned tools. These are the only signs that people once thrived in this unusual home. The lookout has left no tracks, and in the moments you spend scanning the narrow, trash-strewn street, no one else emerges. Beyond this bleak emptiness, two things rise. Nearby, a kind of pavilion or howdah built atop the whale's head, and in the distance, a huge stone stern castle at the whale's rear. A beam of light streams from the stern castle to the howdah, encasing the latter in an iridescent bubble. Some sort of shield by the look of it. There's nothing else of note. Search for any survivors. After a sharp turn, you slip into a square that is half smothered by the stench of what seems a heap of garbage. Without a shudder, you see it is in fact a mound of rotting bodies. Cornered between the corpse pile and a rustling sheet metal shanty, a woman guards a few canned goods around a crowd of lean-faced men and women. Their gestures seem mere speechless, beseeching, were it not for the woman's torn flesh and one man's bloody nails. She hoarsely wands them off, vowing to die fighting. And die she surely will, though these half-starved foes would pose no threat to a trained warrior like you. Though you are nearly close enough to touch them, the lightbender hides you from sight. I don't want to end the lightbender's protection. Kick the food to the crowd and see the woman is safe. You kick the cans with a cloaked foot, and the crowd falls upon them with wordless greed. For her part, the woman breaks and runs. To keep her safe, you are forced to give chase. Before you catch her, she slips around a corner and fades into a far larger mob gathered at the very gates of the stern castle. Most of these mute men and women are hammering against the gates with crude tools or just their fists. As you stare, new arrivals file in behind you, blindly cutting off retreat. The lightbender's power peters out, as you shimmer into view, a few members of the mob glance your way. You're in no immediate danger, but fighting this many would be no mean feat. Climb the stern castle wall and gain entry through a window. As the mob spots you ascending, they fall upon you with senseless desperation. Sharp, nailed hands clutch at your limbs. Cudgels batter your body. How sweet. But your climbing claws have a good grip, and your arms and legs are strong. Stronger than most anyone's, and stronger than those of these sick folk by a wide measure. Eventually you work your way out of their reach, safe if not unscathed. Above you shimmers the beam of energy fueling the howdah's distant force field. Below you faces contort in voiceless rage. You give both sights but the quickest glance before swinging your way through an open window. You land deftly in a great hall. The stern castle's defenders are a few dozen men and women, armed with little more than spears and marlin spikes. One of them has a few healing ciphers, another wears a richly dyed robe adorned with glittergar scales. No doubt she is their leader. The hall holds little else of interest save a large Numenera that streams energy out through a window, feeding the force field at the whale's head. The defender's leader addresses you, her voice oddly accented. "Welcome to Folkhaven, emissary," she says gently. "I speak for the folk. We must dock in your city. We are in desperate need of healing, as you saw when you faced the unspeakables. We beg your aid in these dark days." "Who are you?" With ritual air, the speaker throws back her shoulders, glittergar scales shimmering. "We are the folk, wayfarers and truth-tellers, survivors of a land that sank beneath the sea for our sins." She continues in a slightly less formal tone. "We have plied the waves for 7 generations, kept above by the whale singer's skill, never growing beyond the bounds of this haven, small enough for each to know all, for all to know their places, from speaker to gleaner, from watcher to teacher." A wave of her arm covers the defenders huddled in the hall. "Now we are few. Perhaps some sinned in the old selfish way and brought the gods' wrath upon us again." She shrugs, "but we shall endure." "Who are these unspeakables?" "Three of our folk hauled in a net that held a foul catch, a thing, partwise fish and partwise woman, but long and bald and clawed, big with child and clutching in its grip a thing that glowed, some sea cipher." She shakes her head, "so I have heard it said. They flung the foul thing back, but not before it seemed to touch their minds. Those three were the first to fall silent." Her voice is low but strong as she continues. "The plague spread up Fisher's Lane, then through the cannery, stealing voices as it went. Bereft of their words, the sick are cut off from the bonds that hold us folk together. Lost and alone they go mad and turn unspeakable till the quiet death takes them." Hope I'm not spending too much time talking to her. "Why don't the unspeakables just communicate by writing?" "Many of the folk recoil in disgust, but the speaker does not flinch. Of course, a stranger cannot know our ways of wisdom." She gives a gesture that suggests exactly what she thinks of your ignorance. "A spoken lie lasts but a breath, and those who hear it can answer with the truth. But a written lie lingers long past the lives of those who know it to be false, enduring until it can lead an entire race astray." She nods decisively. "So spoke the first of the folk that survived the sinking, and we have lived since by their words, free from the perils of pen and ink." "Ask the doctor to treat your wounds?" The chirurgeon nods and gestures you toward him. "Sit, please," he says, pointing to a simple wooden chair. As you rest for a moment, he begins his work with ciphers that are far from simple, relics, perhaps, of some more prosperous time. The care you receive is quick but effective, and at least some of your wounds are gone. "I want to help your people, but you must turn away from Sega's cliffs, or the cannons will destroy the whale." The speaker is, for a moment, speechless. The defender's eyes are all turned upon her, and a look of horror and nausea blanches her face. Then, with visible effort, she composes herself. "You have spoken, and I have heard." She lowers herself to her knees. "But I again implore you and your far-famed city to aid us in our hour of need. The lives of the folk and the fate of the haven turn upon your word." The hall falls silent, awaiting your reply. "If I could let you dock and save your people, I would, but it's not my word. The decision has already been made." The speaker pushes herself to her feet, and brushes off her knees. I do not fault those who speak for your city. We have done the same here to safeguard the uninfected within these walls. But we cannot change course from here. She points to the window through which the Numenera sends its energy. The whale singer guides the whale from upon its head, and he must be shielded against plague. Were he to lose his voice, there would be no song to steer us. A grim, false smile cuts her face, but there is a way. You see, a gift has come to us, a means by which the healer can concoct an inoculation against a quiet death. It comes at a price, one your city will make us pay. She points to a boy huddled nearby and calls him over. The gift. The only one to fall sick and silent, yet fend off madness. She strokes his hair. From the fluid in his spine, the healer will decant a guard against the death. She gestures for him to sit. Not a cure, and enough for at least 20, for at most 20 inoculations. You count more than that in the hall. From 20, the folk can grow again, as we did after the sinking. She smiles at the boy. The gift will not refuse or cry out. He will endure his death in silence. She takes her hand. We will lower the shield, and you will bring an inoculation to the whale singer. The whale will turn, and we will survive. Right. I did that. There must be some other way to stop the disease. For a few moments, the speaker says nothing, and when she answers, her voice is composed. You will recognize, I trust, that I would not lightly speak of killing a child if there were some better way before us. What if the procedure fails? You'll have killed the only one of your people immune to the disease. The speaker shakes her head. We are not fools, stranger, and long have we pondered our few choices. Even if the gift survives, the folk shall die, for he cannot speak the word and keep our ways alive. She nods to the chirurgeon, and the healer knows his craft and his tools. He has said this will not fail, and I speak his words again with confidence. How about not kill the child slayers and destroy the Numenera with your concussive crystal? With an almost casual gesture, you fling the concussive crystal against the shield-generating Numenera. The sound is deafening, the light blinding, the force of the successive explosions enough to knock you off your feet. When your senses return, you see the slaughter you have worked. Oh, they're dead anyway. Most of the folk are dead, the speaker and child among them. Others are wounded. Armless, the doctor slithers across the floor to some uncertain end. Most are dying, all are helpless. Damn it. The ribbon of energy that once flowed from the machine, through the window, into the distant howdah is gone. The hall is dark, and the darkness is rich with the sound, the smell and sound of death. Okay. I'm gonna try not to be that brutal. Leave the survivors and set out for the howdah and the whale singer. The collar around your neck hums and a voice warns, make haste, the whale has entered the bay. You heed its command. As you weave through the narrow paths and alleys, faint sounds stir in the distance, the shuffle of footsteps, the huffing of heavy breaths. With a watchful eye and quiet tread, you advance, keeping out of sight as best you can. Soon they are before you, a gang of unspeakables at least a dozen strong, making their starving, reaving way through the village, and unknowingly barring your advance. You are not here to cleanse the haven. Sneak past them. Be quicker, right? If it works. The same hovels that make a maze of the folk haven provide endless cover for the adept. Slipping through doors, slinking through alleys, and leaping from roof to roof, you evade the unspeakables and make your way, at last, to the howdah. That's skill, man. Whoever the hell I'm playing as. The howdah's force... Okay, that's him. The howdah's force field has fallen. Within the pavilion stands a stocky man. That's stocky. Barrel-chested and ruddy. Looks kind of skinny, actually. The whale singer. He seems equal parts weary, bewildered, and battle-ready. Behind him, wide-mouthed tubes rise up from the whale's hide, and past him is the flat expanse of the whale's brow. Not so far beyond are the cliffs, the cannons, and the city. The whale singer's voice booms when he speaks, his words accented like the speaker's. I do not know you, stranger, and I tremble at the way you have come. What do you want? The cannons directly ahead of us will destroy the whale unless you change its course away from Sega's cliffs. The whale singer shakes his head, in sadness, not stubbornness. The speaker told me to guide our haven to this city, where we may find a cure for the quiet death. I cannot turn from that path and leave the folk without succor. My duty is to my people. He glances at your sword and adds, whatever the price I may personally pay, whatever price the others have paid already. We're wasting time. I should choose 4. All of Fullcaven will pay the price when the cannons obliterate the whale. Intimidation. The whale singer slowly nods. Your words have the sound of truth. I do not know what you have done, or what the plague will wreak, but an uncertain sea is better than certain shoals. So I guess I don't choose, you know, our, you know, level we want for intimidation. Was it effort? With that, he turns to the tubes rising from the whale flesh and works his craft. It is an uncanny song he sings, inhuman, and at the same time, heart-achingly intimate. At once, the whale begins to turn, heaving its huge bulk away from the city and back to the open seas. And then the song ends, and the whale singer takes a long swig from a flask chained to his belt. It is done. Seconds later, the collar around your neck flickers, and a voice whispers, to you alone, do not let it turn back. How do you steer the whale? The whale singer waves a hand at the trumpet-like bronze tubes, rising from the creature's hide. When I sing, the salpinges bear my song into her very brain, stirring the nerves within as if my voice were her own. What I sing, she must do. He kneels and places a hand on the huge head beneath him. It is a duty and an honor to join the Great One's mind. I soothe her loneliness and hold her back when the males roar their lust through the seas. Thus have I, and the many singers before me, kept Fullcaven from sinking below the waves. Tell me more about the whale. The whale singer shakes his head. Each whale singer teaches his craft to a song student, who will in turn live to become singer himself. A sadness steals over his face. Though the student is gone, you are not of the folk, and cannot take his place. He merely shakes his head. Yeah. I'm gonna have to fulfill my duty to kill him to ensure the whale will not be turned back toward the Sega's cliffs. As you slip loose your wind-slice blade, the whale singer pulls a sword off his own from a sheath on his back. It is a humble weapon and age-worn, but its wielder is strong and desperate to survive. He puts up some fight, but in the end, the man is a singer, while you are a killer. You make it as quick and painless as you can. The whale takes no notice of his death, and merely glides on its new course, at last unbound and free to wander as it will. I don't kill the whale. Return to the Tao. You race down the whale's head and leap into your Tao. With a swift slash, you cut the harpoon loose. Moments later, the whale is already dwindling into the distance. Whatever fate awaits the folk and the unspeakables, it will be resolved at sea, far from the city you were sent to protect. As you slip from its shadow, the indigo waves turn azure. Your kalo trembles, and the voice returns. Well done. Cleanly done. Rightly done. Then, silence. The wind bears you back toward home. You do not bother to watch the vanishing whale with the dying village on its back, for ahead of you grows the great city of Sega's cliffs, its buildings, then its people, coming slowly into view. They are safe. Okay, there's that one. Okay. It's curious if I try to go in it again. No way to access again. Now, this one, the twisted metal, hold on. Just in case. I don't know where we're gonna end up. Probably someplace we've already been that I may not want to return to. You pull the Merecaster from your belongings again. It sings to you in tangled words beyond your understanding, urging you to sample the memories locked within. Whatever interfered did we unlocked his Merecaster is beyond you. You twist and turn the Merecaster as you think he did, but nothing happens. I'm gonna see if we can ask him more about the people around here. Then I'm gonna look at this, waits for prey. Again. The time of mere mortals is not of the same scale allotted to castoffs, friend. I urge you to speed your search. Who was that automaton you were speaking to? That, my friend, was one of the Decanted. They are servants of the nobles of the City of Glass, a nearly extinct people who value beauty and form. Had I known your interest, I might have suggested it speak to you. However, as I understand it, your body is artificially grown. They prefer their guests organic. He slashes his hand through the air, signifying the end of the discussion. Let us speak of something else. Back to this guy.
I'm ready. I'm always ready.
Yeah, you ready for this? Cause this is gonna be a rather crazy battle, huh? Sorry guys, I keep saving. I don't know what's gonna happen right now. And what if I tell it to kill me?